So ballast is used to, it's used to help the, not only to help keep the boat upright, but to counterbalance the wind on the sail. So when you have a sail and the wind blows like this, it's naturally going to push the boat to the side. It'll cause heel. And then we've got this really heavy mass down low because the water might be here. And the heavy mass is down there, and it also wants to go down. So it's kind of getting lifted almost, so it kind of pulls it back up. And so it's like a righting moment. So not only when the wind blows does it kind of help the boat stand upright, get more wind, sail faster, right? But it also inhibits it traveling sideways through the water. Like the leeway, so it doesn't, it's hard because it basically has something sticking into the water that wants it to go straight, so it can point or can go like straighter, more close to the wind, close sailed, so it can point better into the wind.
So in the old days, all the weight of the ballast was placed in the bilges and in between frames in the form of rocks and stones and railways and whatever you find heavy. And that would provide the righting moment. Ceiba's design is progressive in this regard, that it's a hybrid between, say, a regular sailing boat, which has a ballast fin, keel, and a cargo ship. She will be able to carry more sail area. So her journeys will be more efficient because she will be capable of pointing closer to the wind and heading closer upwind.
Fue un proceso bastante largo, tedioso, un trabajo muy delicado, muy pesado. Se hizo con muchísimo cuidado. Las vigas cuando llegaron acá, las vigas H de 12 metros, se seccionaron de acuerdo a los planos, ¿verdad? De acuerdo a lo que los constructores de los barcos nos pidieron. Se seccionaron y se hicieron las secciones, se soldaron con un soldado certificado especial porque lleva, es bastante delicado el asunto con la soldadura, ¿verdad? Y una vez que la sección ya está lista, de acuerdo a los planos específicos del bote, se limpia por completo el material, el metal, para dejarlo al desnudo, metal desnudo, y luego se pinta con la pintura especial para el balastro, ¿verdad?
One is, it would be, you could say a cold, it's a zinc paint, it's a gray zinc primer, and so that has a fair amount of zinc in it, which is, it offers, I believe, well, cathodic or anodic protection. There's more than just painting it. There's something electrical going on. And then we have another red oxide rust paint on top of that. And then we have a two-part epoxy on top of that.
Nosotros hicimos desde cero los 32 tornillos para la quilla con barra de 32 milímetros. Acá se corta, se tornea, se le hace la rosca. Bueno, esos son con rosca en ambos extremos. Entonces no se solda ninguna cabeza, pero son dos procesos separados de rosca, digamos. Y fueron 32 tornillos en esa longitud y con esa barra, y luego con la misma barra de 32 milímetros tenemos que hacer como unos 10 tornillos más extra largos, como entre 1.70 y 1.90. Y al final se llevan allá al barco para presentarlos, para ver que den bien el largo y todo el asunto. Y ya ellos los ponen ya con la tuerca y todo el asunto, con las arandelas, las tuercas y con la brea que se usa para que el agua no los herrumbre.
So the installation process was pretty neat. At times we lifted the tractor, we used the tractor to lift the piece, and it was taking the back wheels, like the tractor is up on two wheels, and we're going, all right, we have to move the tractor to the other side so that it's kind of on the downhill side of the piece, just to try and keep those wheels on the ground. And that's how heavy it was, right? It was just really heavy. And so those pieces were then, we had a post and a square tubing, like steel square tubing. It wasn't anything overly beefy. And then on that was a roller was welded to it, just like you might see at the airport or something when you put your bags to roll across, and welded them in place on top of the square tubing. It's pretty cool. And so we go with the tractor and we get it all lined up in the direction it needed to go with the front top end up, just because they, like you mentioned, Eli, they welded bevels and had it all aligned. And so, and then we'd lift it up and kind of do our best with the tractor. We tied a rope on one end because we wanted, so I could help control it while Arthur was driving the tractor to, you know, drive in with all the space that we had with the tractor and lower it onto two rollers. Then the tractor would come out and we'd kind of push it from the front and we'd get it like 10 feet in the stern of the boat or whatever, 10 feet under the vessel, like not very far. So then what we ended up doing was getting a winch, drive the Toyota Land Cruiser or the Samurai, and we'd roll it on, say, the three rollers, and then when the fourth roller was free, we'd pick it up and walk back to the front. And then when the cable went all the way in, we'd unhook the ropes and stretch the cable back out and tie it onto the next rope. And then from there, we'd go with chain blocks and start to lift it up to get it to the plate. And if we need to adjust it, we'll lift up an end with the jack and move the sliders because maybe they run out of room.
I suppose we can afford to have it so far away from the keel, but I was thinking to drop it on the rollers as they are right now.
What came up to try and do is to lift it up. We can see how far we can push it over by hand right now,
yeah,
and lower it down, move it, and do that.
Oh yeah, lots of extra space, eh? Really close, man.
So we have this 1.2 ton I-beam hanging, then we could lift it up to, like, you know, like right under where we want it to go, or just above even, because it's pretty heavy. And we'd put wood under it with two pieces of hard, like, wapinol, and they've been we put a little bit of grease on them, then we put a little bit of oil on them, and the combination of grease and oil was pretty slippery. And then we could literally push it in. So this thing is, like, super heavy, and we're just like, whoop.
It was my idea because back in England, we used to move entire boats on the cradle, and there was just like two sets of plywoods, sheets of plywood, and with grease in between, and we were just sliding them around. Very rudimental, low-tech method of maneuvering heavy objects.
And we could jack it up into place and, like, look and take it down. And we'd usually do it two or three times, plane it. And then the other aspect of it is that where those blocks that we took out, where there were holes that were drilled that we couldn't access until we take the blocks out. So we'd take them out and bore out all the holes for these keel bolts. So then we have all the holes bored out. Then we'd go into the bilge, where these beautiful holes were drilled. Like, wow, I think it was Manu and Dan. They're drilling through 3 feet of wood and they've got a target that big to hit. And they did, like, pretty much every time.
And then marking the holes, because the holes in the keel, and mark the holes, take the I-beam again out and drill the holes through the I-beam using the magnet drill. Provides a stable drilling position, and it's it doesn't move and it's perpendicular to your drilling surface. So the holes are pretty accurate. because you can drill exactly where you marked at exactly the right angle. So pounding in the bolts was no fun whatsoever. It just, it was sore back basically. But we did it, and that had to be done, and we did it.
And then we'd hammer these, I think they're 1 1/8 or 1 1/4 inch hardened steel keel bolts that are 3 feet long. Yeah, so we put tar and we put a layer of torch on, and then we cover that with more tar. And that is, I mean, it's partly, it's gonna fill in any gaps and voids. It's going to make like an electrical seal. I mean, yeah, ideally what happens is we know everything. So that's the last thing to balance the vessel out. And when she goes in the water, it's just like, sits exactly like we want it to sit. That'd be ideal. Beams, the four main ballast keel sections currently are, the steel alone is 1.2 ton per piece. And so that will put, my understanding is that we'll be having approximately 35 ton of really heavy material as low in the water as possible at the bottom of the boat, hanging out of the bottom of the boat. Like if it hits the ground, that's the first thing to hit.
Ahorita estamos en el manglar Morales, así es como se llama este manglar. Una zona de amortiguamiento y es una zona también, un área protectora, una área protegida aquí para los ecosistemas de la parte baja del corredor biológico Pájaro Campano. Bueno, los manglares primero son una esponja y para contener los desastres naturales y los humanos también. Segundo, es un corredor biológico en la costa, donde existe ecosistemas y hábitats exclusivos en los manglares. Nosotros estamos haciendo aquí un estudio de impacto ambiental para obtener viabilidad ambiental. Sin embargo, ese estudio es para poder sacar el barco, el Ceiba, al agua a 200 metros de distancia de tierra, de la marea alta. ¿Verdad? Entonces, primero se hace todo un estudio biológico para poder saber cómo están los suelos, qué profundidad tiene, si se necesita dragar, si se necesita crear alguna estructura y si es permitido crear esa estructura por ahí.
So what we're putting in here is the centerline posts that basically bring this center of, or the strength for all the deck beams, tween deck beams and weather deck up from the keel, which is our sort of strongest base of strength. With, we've got I-beams, keelson, keel, two more I-beams down there, and this is all one big solid package, so it's super, super strong. It's the spine of the boat. And we want to transfer that strength up into these deck beams because they span about 7 or 8 meters across midships, which is quite a bit when you've got loads of cargo in here. There's going to be, you know, tons of coffee, so it's a lot of weight. And it helps stiffen the boat laterally because the ocean's pressing on the sides of the boat. So the more you can do to strengthen and stiffen everything in here is key. So the first thing we had to do was weld these tangs onto the keelson rider to bolt the bottoms of these posts in. And the posts are, you can't see it because it's behind this piece now, but there's some joinery where it's notched into this member, which this is designed to spread the load out from so it doesn't point load, you know, completely into the deck beam. It sort of spreads it out a little more. So once those are on, if you come to the one just after, you can see it complete. There's a metal strap that goes up and over the top, which is notched into the deck beam. So it fits over and ties that whole piece together. And then there's upper deck beams that stand on top of those. So it's the same process. They go up and gather into these other supports on the top. And then there's an L bracket on either side of that that's through bolted and then through bolted here. So together that whole junction is very, very strong. Thank you.